John is a front man. In my opinion, he's the best in the business. Still to this day, I see him on stage and I'm standing right next to him and I just go, man, this guy is just amazing.
You can't imagine sort of not taking it to the next level, not constantly working towards something better or something new.
A movie star is someone that the audience just is intrinsically interested in watching them. John has that quality.
And now Bravo profiles John Bon Jovi. The name John Bon Jovi conjures images of the flashy rock star whose anthemic songs and pretty boy looks defined rock stardom in the 1980s.
The thing about John is he definitely has star quality. The guy is terminally handsome and great presence, and he's very, very tenacious.
While never a favorite of rock critics, he's won millions of loyal fans with his hard-driving stage show and uplifting message. He's kept his star aloft for nearly 20 years with an uncanny ability to evolve with the times and yet remain true to his New Jersey roots.
The secret of him is that he's this great looking, great singing, blues great rocker, and yet you could have like grown up with him.
When he hits the stage running and does not stop.
But this driven superstar wasn't satisfied with rock stardom alone, and in the early 90s, his restless creative energy drove him to Hollywood.
When he decided he wanted to be an actor, it wasn't about, you know, I'm a great big rock star, you gotta do it. He was going out, he was doing all those auditions. I mean, the guy has drive.
How did John Bon Jovi, once dismissed as a fleeting MTV icon, ultimately bridge the gap between lead singer and leading man?
I wanted to do things that were gonna push me as an individual. So I didn't get lazy, you know, so I didn't take what I did for my day job and become the Fat Elvis.
My life. It's Ted with John Bon Jovi. Hello.
Wake up.
There you go.
Hello. Yeah? I'm in a place called Morelos, Mexico, on my way to the film set. I think that the great pleasure for me is balancing music and movies. So we did 50 shows and it was great, and then I cooled it to do this.
It's February 2001, and John Bon Jovi is as far from the scene of his rock stardom as possible. He's starring in the ninth film of his acting career, tentatively titled Los Muertos.
Hola.
The film has been shooting all over Mexico, and the current set is an abandoned sugar mill in the remote town of Cuautla.
There.
Yeah.
Welcome to my new home.
There are vampires everywhere. There goes Keith Richards.
In this quirky spaghetti western, John plays Derek Bliss, a small-time vampire hunter tackling the biggest challenge of his career.
I'm off camera?
No.
You mean I have to be in the movie?
Yeah.
Most rock stars, if they try to get into the movie game, they want to do some big star vehicle befitting their majesty, like Tommy or Evita. And Bon Jovi, I think, has done it in a different way, and with a kind of refreshing modesty. He has taken small parts, he's taken character parts. He's more serious about being an actor than a lot of rock stars have been.
Here she comes.
Try to pull, she's on me.
There you go, about like that. Let's see.
Anything that's good that comes to you, you have to work really hard for. And I think that he's working really hard at the acting thing. I mean, really, really working at it. Not expecting anybody to hand it to him.
Two questions then. Should I toss it to him on the out at some point? Or there was one stunt that we had rehearsed 2 months ago where
he's a conscientious actor. He really, really wants to penetrate past his part into the essence of the movie. He's thinking all the time about the story and how his part in it illuminates the story and gets the story told effectively.
I still have the rope, therefore I can't fight, and then she comes and gets me again.
It's too late.
I'm down.
Exactly.
I'm drawn to storytelling, and in this case, you know, I mean, this isn't the genre of film I wanted to grow up and do. You know, I'd like to find some great dramatic roles eventually. But when Tommy was so excited by the prospect of making it a deeper, more intelligent film, and his vision of it being not a dark, ghoulish, seen that, done that vampire movie, it was appealing to me.
Off he goes, right over that thing.
In his pursuit of an acting career, John must adapt to circumstances that are very different from what he knows as a rock star.
It's much different than what I do in the music business. I'm creating something that someone else has handed me. And it's been a long time since I've ever done other people's stuff. it's sort of like, you know, interpreting a lyric as opposed to it being your own.
Action. Keep an eye on both of us.
He goes to play Giant Stadium. He's going to pull up. There's going to be a sound check. There's going to be, you know, 50,000 people, you know, that want to rip his clothes off. It's like, yeah, you know. He's done that, right? But I bet you that there's a certain element of danger of actually going onto a set, working with other actors, a director throwing you something. These kinds of things, I think, probably give him that element of butterflies that I think is an important part of the creative process.
Action!
You know, it's a very lonely job being an actor. You're one person alone. You know, you walk on there and it's just you. When you have a band, there's four other guys standing beside you fighting the same fight.
John being a rock star makes his career more difficult, his career as an actor, much more difficult. Because he brings with him baggage.
He knew that for building his acting career, he needed to show Hollywood that if you put Bon Jovi into a movie, it's not going to distract anybody from the movie. That his acting ability is greater than the star baggage that he brings to it by virtue of his rock and roll career.
There's so many times I've heard, I can't get by the persona. I have no problem, you know, shaving my head or growing a beard. That's what actors are supposed to do.
I think for him it's refreshing on a movie crew because there aren't a lot of sycophants hanging around. It's just people who like him, respect him, know him to be a hard worker, and he's part of the group.
You want to know what movie stars eat? Grilled chicken, boring broccoli, and water. Nothing good.
What's so cool is to find somebody who's had success for 20 years and for them to have not lost touch with reality, man. John is real as it gets. John is a family man. His family came down. Mother and his father came down. John exudes with family and loyalty is about.
I'm fired. You're in.
Yeah, it'll take a while to light this. The director of photography takes over. They light it and all. They want us out of the way.
Family and home have always been the mainstays of John's life, and despite the fact that his career has brought him to every corner of the globe, he remains physically and emotionally attached to the places he knew as a child. In fact, he married his high school sweetheart, Dorothea, and lives with her and their two children 10 miles from his childhood home.
I grew up in a place called Sarahville, New Jersey. A great little second-generation ethnic community. The place they wrote those Americana songs about picket fences and Little League and running around. You know, your father would whistle at dinner time in the house, like the streetlights would go on, it was time to go home.
John was born March 2nd, 1962, the oldest of John and Carol Bon Jovi's three sons.
My dad was a hairdresser, and my mother held a variety of jobs. She had a floral shop, at one point a gift shop. I think I spent the first 21 years of my life trying to get out of there, and the next 20 trying to get back.
His life in Jersey and where he came from, he hasn't left any of it. And that keeps him a real human being.
Somewhere, something got in him. I don't think it came from reading about it in books, but something deeper and bigger got in him about the big things that there are to do in life. And I feel like he was really inspired by that.
He didn't seem like somebody who was ruthlessly ambitious as much as someone who just had a very clear idea that he was going to be prominent.
Every parent tells their kid they can grow up to be president. But I just said, okay, okay, you're going to do that. There was just never a doubt in my mind that I was going to not only make records, but I would continue to make records for as long as I cared to make them.
How does the landing site look?
You guys will be there waiting.
Today is my one and only day off. What am I doing? Going back to my day job.
When I'm on a movie set, I don't even want to think about the music business. When I'm doing music, I don't even want to think about the movie business. And once in a while, the two have to meet.
John's day job as frontman of the band Bon Jovi takes him to Mexico City, where he'll play a brief acoustic show for fans at a record store. No matter where he is in the world, his fame as a musician is never far behind.
Okay, so we're going to an in-store. I'm going to perform. I have no idea what. Should I play old and new, borrowed and blue? Am I in good voice today? These are the interesting questions we'll find out right after this dated point.
He's not afraid when he's performing. He's used to it. 30,000 people, 70,000 people. He says, come on, let me, you know, come and get me. I'm here.
As with most superstars and frontmen, he's very giving and yet very egocentric, which is a combination that really works if you're going to, you know, play to 20,000 or 60,000 people every night.
It turned into a great release for me, telling the stories and playing the songs. It was a lot of fun for me. You know, I was supposed to do 10 minutes and kept going because I remembered what I did for a living. My parents at least were as supportive as they could be. They thought, if you're going to be in a bar till 3 in the morning, at least we know where you are.
To accommodate John's shooting schedule on the movie, Bon Jovi has taken a break from touring, and the band members haven't seen each other in 4 months.
Hey, man, how are you?
Good, pal.
How's it going, man?
Bon Jovi is in the midst of a renaissance in popularity that has seen their most recent album, Crush, released in the summer of 2000, go double platinum, and their concerts sell out across the country. Now they convene in a rehearsal studio to tune up their live show before kicking off the next leg of their world tour.
I'm fortunate enough to have had a lot of people around me in my life that have been there for a long time. Dave's been my keyboard player since I'm 16 years old. You know, Richie's been here since 83, and Tico and Huey played on Runaway. There's been an underlying sense of both community and undying loyalty amongst the members that is one of the big reasons why we came through the, you know, the ups and the downs.
I think I'm worried about it. How many years we've been doing this before? It'll be great.
I've known John forever. Known him since he was 18. He was the kid hanging around. We used to see him all the time. It was great, a lot of fun. In the 70s and 80s, the best place to be was Asbury Park for music.
By 1979, while still in high school, John was a regular on the thriving Asbury Park club circuit.
The bar scene in New Jersey at that particular point in time was just flourishing. Drinking age was low, 18 years old. I mean, you could find work as a musician on a Monday night.
Here on the Jersey Shore, when you looked at the South Side, Johnny or Bruce or Little Steven, that was the ultimate goal. Because they made records, and they made records in my backyard, it gave you the feeling that the impossible was possible.
I think Asbury Park was hugely important to him. South Side Johnny and Bruce Springsteen were his icons. The Stone Pony, where Springsteen played, was a kind of Valhalla to him.
The club that I used to play in wasn't, in fact, the Stone Pony, but a place called the Fastlane.
John formed a band called the Atlantic City Expressway, whose members included current Bon Jovi keyboard player Dave Bryan. Photographer Pat Seeley was on hand to capture some of the earliest images of John on stage.
John was about 16 in those days. Probably the drinking age was 18, so he wasn't even old enough to get in the club.
of course, go to school the next morning. I think he wore sunglasses to hide the fact that he was struggling to stay awake.
My parents at least were as supportive as they could be. They thought, if you're going to be in a bar till 3 in the morning, at least we know where you are. You know?
John had a great energy on stage. You could tell that he meant what he was singing, and he just put his all into it. He had a way of drawing you into his song.
You got to go out there and win these people, and it's a nightly thing. It's not about standing there and what we call shoe staring. If you shoe stare in New Jersey, the next band that comes up is going to whip your ass.
There was a great sense of community. On any given Sunday, you could see any one of the Jukes walking up and down a boardwalk, or you'd see Bruce coming in and, you know, playing with any number of bands.
Sure enough, one night Bruce came down here to check out the band. You could hear the opening harmonica chords to Promised Land, and then I guess Bruce saw that as a great opportunity, and you just saw a black leather jacket cut through the crowd. Bruce jumped up on that stage there, and it was an unforgettable performance of Promised Land.
The guys that were the next level of success would often offer words of encouragement, so you really learned at that time, even at 16, 17, it's not about playing covers your whole life. Start writing. Start generating something that is your own. And that was the way that I was going to take that little microcosm of Asbury Park and make it, you know, the world.
In 1982, at age 20 and with no record contract in sight, John quit the club circuit and went to work. While doing odd jobs around a New York recording studio, he cut a demo of a song he wrote called Runaway.
I took the tape out to a radio station on Long Island. I walked in the front door, met a DJ who listened to the tape and liked it. And what happened was that was a fluke, and it broke nationally.
With Runaway emerging as a surprise radio hit, John quickly formed a band to capitalize on the song's success. The last to join was an up-and-coming lead guitar player named Richie Sambora.
I walked into this place called the Fountain Casino in New Jersey. And as soon as I walked in, I said, this kid's a star. I knew it.
Claims now in retrospect that he saw something in me that, you know, he knew he could enhance.
So after the show, I kind of went back and said, hi, I'm Richie Sambora, you know. And said, you know, I think I should be in this band.
At first, I thought he was rather arrogant, and, you know, I wasn't very interested.
But 2 weeks later, we got together, and the rest is history.
Bon Jovi exploded into the big time in 1986 with their third album, Slippery When Wet, which sold over 12 million copies and boosted John to the top of the rock world.
It was one of those moments where a star is born. It was a marriage between the music and the times that was a perfect union.
I traveled with them for a period of time, going from town to town, and the scene was exactly as you would imagine if you were going to describe the classic rock and roll band on tour, with screaming girls, with groups of kids hanging out outside the hotel room hoping just to catch this tiny glimpse of the band.
I was in a rock band that was on the cover of every magazine in the universe, selling out every stadium and arena. This was the golden e-ticket, Willy Wonka's Chocolate Factory, man.
You know, when you're the biggest rock and roll band in the world, young-blooded American boys traveling throughout the globe. It was a lot of fun to be had. Wish I could remember more of it.
John remembered the lessons he learned in Asbury Park and took them to the global stage. Night after night, Bon Jovi's live shows stood out for their mix of raw energy and showmanship. Just as important for John, Slippery When Wet was proof that he had arrived as a songwriter.
With the first two records, songwriting was a learning process. With the third record, I realized that by telling a fictional story, but based on people that you knew in situations that they were in, you'd be a better storyteller. Living on a Prayer was the beginning of the storytelling era.
It's the factory worker, the guy on the street, the waitress, you know, or the secretary, the real people of America. That's what he's writing about, and that's who he's singing to.
People wanted to be Tommy and Gina. They still do.
breathtaking success of Slippery When Wet and its 1988 follow-up New Jersey, Bon Jovi had become the biggest rock band of its era. They dominated radio with a remarkable string of 8 top 10 singles and played sold-out stadiums around the world.
They seemed to work very well as a group. The personalities were very different, but seemed pretty harmonious. John was the quiet, more mysterious, more inaccessible figure.
I think from the very beginning, John has been the one who is focused on the business aspect of things, focused on the deals, focused on where he's going.
I saw so many of the other bands that I knew personally kind of dissipate, and they couldn't keep their business together. The leadership of John Bon Jovi made such a difference.
After 2 grueling world tours and constant media exposure, John began to feel worn down. At 28 years old, the pressure and responsibilities of being the band's leader and namesake began to take a serious toll.
If you were to talk to the guys in the band about their experience with the Slippery When Wet era, you'd think that it was 2 different bands, because mine was, just put the blinders on, and I wasn't in good health, and it was very grueling to sing 240 shows.
He was wrecking his throat, man. He was getting steroid shots in his neck to keep the swelling down of his cords. We were just kids, and we didn't know. You figure you're bulletproof. He had that Superman tattoo on his arm.
Another show on another continent, in another time zone, and another cortisone shot. There was such animosity in my belly for what this had become, because it went from that great sense of, on 3, everybody pick up the B3 organ and put it on the stage, to this virtual corporation that was employing 100 people and running around the globe in airplanes and trucks and buses. And, it wasn't the pure joy for me of getting up there and doing it anymore. And I had to get back to that.
And when we return,
I eventually got the courage to try it. Go to an audition. See what happened. Let it open you up from being a one-trick pony.
What makes a great performance? Years of hard work. By 1990, after a relentless climb to the top of the music world, 28-year-old John Bon Jovi was burned out on rock stardom.
The band had taken a 2-year period off so I could reassess what it was about the music business that drew me to it in the first place.
It was during this break that John met Emilio Estevez, star of the hit western Young Guns. The two became friends and decided that John should try his hand at writing some songs for the upcoming sequel, Young Guns 2.
So I went home and wrote Blaze of Glory and a couple of other songs and went out to the set in Santa Fe.
He says, I wrote a little song and I want to play it for you. And I said, sure. So he sat down and he had it written down on notebook paper, and he had an acoustic guitar, and we're sitting in the house and he just started playing Blaze of Glory, and my jaw fell open.
I think in John's emotional landscape, there are tumbleweeds kind of roaming through town. He sees himself as a kind of gunslinger, as a desperado, as a lone gunman.
We would ride into town, play the show, have some fun, have our way with whoever was there, and leave again and do the same thing the next night. So it was a bit of an outlaw thing going on.
In retrospect, the Young Guns record is 50% about Billy the Kid and 50% about me.
The song went on to be just a massive hit for him. He won the Golden Globe, he got nominated for an Oscar. I think it sort of changed the complexion of his career, and I think it took, people sort of looked at him in a different light.
It was a wonderful sense of pride and achievement. But when the phone rings and they say, hey, your record's number one, you go, okay. And you're hanging up the phone and there's no one to high five with.
In 1992, following John's solo project, Bon Jovi the band reemerged on the rock scene, only to find that the landscape of American popular music had been greatly altered.
When you have a record like Slippery When Wet,
and it's followed up by a record like New Jersey, and then that's followed up with an enormous solo record with Blaze of Glory. I thought, welcome to the 90s, man. How are you going to beat this? 1, 2, 3, you know, you can't. You could. Kurt Cobain came along and kicked it right in the teeth.
Rock music scene changed in the early 90s into a less glamorous scene with the rise in popularity of bands such as Nirvana and Pearl Jam.
Radio in America certainly began to turn its back, and we had to rely on the occasional hit instead of the guaranteed, you know, 5-hit singles that New Jersey spawned.
Bon Jovi was struggling to live up to the high expectations that had been set in the 80s. U.S. sales for their albums Keep the Faith in 1992 and These Days in 1996 fell to less than a quarter of their previous albums.
We went about our business and they didn't try to pretend all of a sudden we were from Seattle and had all that angst, because we didn't.
Bon Jovi and his message is positive and enthusiastic. It's not cynical and dark.
To make the comparison to a band like Nirvana, which was all about a deeply pessimistic view of music, life, the world, they were completely different kinds of postures.
John often says, you know, people glamorize those rock and roll bands that have all these incredible stories of drugs and booze and troubles and
much.
All that. And he said probably, you know, if Bon Jovi was the kind of band that would go out there and sell all those stories and talk about all that, maybe they'd even be critically more respected.
It's pop music, and it does very well, and it's maddening, I think, to critics, because it seems like it's being done without much struggle or much conflict within it.
You work real hard to get to a place where you try to write the best songs you can write, make the best albums you can write, and play for all the people, and you just pour your blood all over the stage and heart out. And the critics just go, yeah, of course there is.
You know, we've had our ups and our downs, and, you know, I know what it's like to be down, man. I didn't mind it. You know, it didn't make me miserable or make me think less of myself or the body of work.
He forges ahead with what he thinks is important and what he wants to do, which is what makes him not a caricature or not a sellout or not a phony.
Single-minded will to succeed in the face of adversity is behind each new challenge that John tackles. In 1992, inspired by his experience on the set of Young Guns 2, he sought out the services of acting coach Harold Guskin, known for his work with such stars as Kevin Kline, Glenn Close, and Michelle Pfeiffer.
He said, I want to be serious about this. I want to really act. I don't want to just get a part because I'm John Bon Jovi and they want a rocker in this situation. I thought it took a lot of guts to do.
The whole starting over again, it added a great humility to everything I did. At the time, I had become a very popular rock and roll star, and, you know, was traveling around in private planes and playing the biggest stadiums in the world, and you can become very spoiled. You can start thinking that the music is the almighty. This is easy to do. I am wrong.
I really pushed him because I felt that it was dangerous for him because he was so popular. And so I realized, oh, I gotta cut through the crap here.
Talk about humility. I mean, it came to like, you're late, do it again and you're out of here, you know, or sit out in my waiting room because I'm not ready for you.
But I'm not trying to humble him in terms of to take away his sense of self, because I think who he is important. That's what I'm going to use.
With a lot of time and a lot of hard work, he started to throw me the occasional bonus. Well, you don't suck. That was his way of saying, you're doing a good job.
Finally, I said, John, it's time to go out. You're ready. You're ready. Don't worry about it. It's okay. Go. I almost kind of pushed him.
I eventually got the courage to try it. Go to an audition. You know, see what happened. Let it open you up from being a one-trick pony, you know, into broadening your horizon.
And when we return...
I had spent a couple years in a room with my coach. You're doing a love scene with a guy with a beard and a cigar. That's acting, you know.
In 1995, after 3 years of acting lessons and unsuccessful auditions, John got his first break, landing the role of the house painter in the movie Moonlight and Valentino.
It was a hard role to cast. And one day, one of the producers came into my office and she said, how would you feel about John Bon Jovi in this role? I said, what, the singer, the rock guy?
You have preconceptions when you're going to meet someone like John Bon Jovi. You know, you've got the 80s hair look, and you're thinking rock star.
From the moment that he sat down and started to read, I mean, snapped my head around.
There was no acting. He didn't act. He just was, which for someone who'd never done this before was kind of mind-blowing.
The first time that I acted with a group of people was on camera in the scene where I come in with the colors to paint their house.
Don't say a word. We know you don't speak any English. Your boss explained it. It's perfectly
okay. It was an adrenaline rush to be stuck in the moment. Acting amongst these accomplished actors isn't something that I was very uncomfortable with as a person. I'd never done it before.
Oh, what a great ass.
There's this duality to him that's really enticing because he has this enormous charisma coupled with this unbelievable down-to-earth quality, which you don't see very often. It reminded me of when I worked with Tom Hanks.
I guess you guys were expecting Umberto.
Oh, no, I was expecting...
Umberto was the guy in the schedule, and anyhow, he's the one that doesn't speak any English. Well, he got sick, you got me, and here. I think you chose a great color. I'm flattered that you like my ass. And if it's okay, I'm going to come back first thing tomorrow morning and get this going, all right?
The last thing that I wanted was to have someone come in and play this as though they knew they were a stud. This character had to be totally unaware of that.
Jesus, I'm almost afraid to ask, but what can you tell about me?
You're really an artist, an oil painter.
Oil painter?
You just paint houses as a sideline thing.
I'm a house painter.
He nailed that scene in the very first take. John says, you sure you don't want another one? I said, why? I said, you did it. You just hit it out of the park.
I had spent a couple years in a room with my coach. You're doing a love scene with a guy with a beard and a cigar. That's acting, you know. It wasn't a pretty girl like Liz Perkins.
I enjoyed it. All the women on the set enjoyed it. You know, girls from the art department, costume people, you know, a couple ladies from the office. All of a sudden, there was all these people standing around the monitor watching John. He said, weren't there this many people here yesterday? I said, no, honey, they're not. They're here to see you kiss me.
In 1996, John won his first starring role in The Leading Man, playing Robin Grange, a disgraced Hollywood actor trying to resurrect his career in London's West End.
It's true, though. I mean, those scenes with me and Rachel, the tension and the suspense at the end, have I really fallen for her? And I get to grab that gun, it's like, bang, 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 you know? I mean, man, that's some climax.
British audiences are suspicious of happy endings.
Americans are just the opposite.
We don't trust happiness.
Why? You think it's going to be taken away or something?
This is the kind of role that you would expect, you know, a rock star to do well, but he doesn't do it the way that you think he's going to. He makes his character kind of humble and sweet. He kind of melds with everybody, but that's, of course, his deception. And watching this performance, you see the way this guy plays everybody. You see his quality of mind, the way he manipulates each person.
I could seduce your wife. Are you crazy? I'm dead serious.
It's scary being on stage.
No. I want you to help me rehearse my toughest scene.
And by the end of the movie, you realize that Bon Jovi hasn't just seduced each of these characters, he's actually kind of seduced the audience.
He's manipulating everyone all the time. And yet, John was enjoying it. He was playing it. It was a thrill to watch.
I liked him. I thought that Robin Grange was in fact a chameleon, and in being a chameleon, he was what you wanted him to be.
After The Leading Man, John explored a diverse series of characters in independent films that allowed him to hone his skills while remaining outside the Hollywood pressure cooker. He entered the studio mainstream in 2000 with a role in the World War II submarine blockbuster U-571. His role as a naval officer on a dangerous espionage mission was the biggest test yet of his range as an actor.
I was a little apprehensive about putting in the movie because I was doing a very realistic period piece. And what I said to John before the picture was, I said, you know, you have to be twice as good as anybody else because you have to be great to play the part, and you have to be twice that great to make me forget that you're John Bon Jovi.
Andy, where you been? It's an all-hands function.
Come here, I want you to meet Joni. Joni, this is Andy Tiles, my best friend.
Hi.
We went to Naples together.
Nice to meet you, John.
Hey, I got you on Larson Stokes.
It's who I need.
Greatest compliment anyone's paid me in U-571 is gone. I didn't know that was you.
50 feet, 10 degree down bubble.
Aye, sir. Chief of the watch, sound the dive alarm.
He fits into the ensemble of the crew perfectly.
Aye, sir, pass you the word.
Could you imagine walking down the tight, narrow hallways of a submarine, not knowing that if around any turn, there would have truly been somebody who may have wanted to kill you at close range?
He just gets these looks of anxiety and fear on his face that are very, very pure, very raw. It reminded me in some ways of Christopher Walken's performance in The Deer Hunter. I think it's that level of just very fierce and intense acting.
He's so accessible that audiences watch it and they go, you know, I believe him. He's credible, I believe him, and he's just like me.
John took a second solo turn in his music career in 1997 with the release of Destination Anywhere, an album full of introspection and soul-searching. It marked the 35-year-old's most ambitious attempt to bring his feelings and personal experiences into his music.
It was such a personal satisfaction to write Destination Anywhere, not worry about if it meant anything to anyone else. It meant a lot to me. It reads more like a diary instead of a commercial venture. As the lyric says in Destination Anywhere, you know, left or right, I don't care. I was off to find out who I was now. Those are the feelings of a guy that's been around now.
Looking for a way to bridge his two careers, John enlisted the help of actors including Whoopi Goldberg, Demi Moore, and Kevin Bacon to create an improvisational movie around the songs.
I'll tell you what the problem is. The problem is that I just don't have the energy for this anymore. Maybe if it was 10 years ago, it'd be a different story. You know, she was stronger, I was stronger.
Do you still love her?
Yeah, I still love her.
The film, about a marriage on the rocks, debuted on MTV.
It was a really interesting idea to make a long-form video.
About Lee.
It was kind of an all-inclusive thing because he was also getting a chance to act. And I think that's sort of what he was looking for, was a way to sort of tie it together.
It's just a way for me to broaden as an artist. And there's just another way to express yourself. I can't paint, you know. No one's asking me for favor. No one's looking for a savior. In the meantime, I have this great day job, you know, making records, that I don't take either one of them less seriously than the other. I don't love either one of them more than the other.
And when we return...
Welcome to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and Museum.
I don't even know if it still fits.
Everybody out of the truck!
War Game.
On our shoulders about being from Jersey, because it was either blind faith or naivete that got me in this seat today. I was in a rock band that was on the cover of every magazine in the universe. I think my goals are that I don't necessarily have goals.
Get inside the creative mind of John Bon Jovi, only on Bravo Profiles. Bravo wants to send you and a friend to Giant Stadium to see John and the boys finish up their sold-out tour. You could also win one of many other prizes. No purchase necessary. Log on to BravoTV.com for rules and instructions.
We are in the van and we are rolling.
And four.
I got pictures of me looking out windows. Different countries, different cities. Just thoughtful look out the window.
Did you hear that, DB?
Oh, no. What?
The event manager said that out of the events they've had, this is by far the largest by at least three times.
It's May 2001, and Bon Jovi is in Cleveland, where the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame has asked them to donate a collection of memorabilia. It's a welcome gesture of recognition for a band whose fans have always believed in their place among rock's greats.
has come full circle from 1986 to 2001. And I think he's even more talented and more relevant to music than he was then.
Hey, buddy.
John's faith is in the future because eventually all popular successes become critical successes. People come back and they look and they say, you know, there must be something there if they sold 100 million albums.
Welcome to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and Museum.
Hello, 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 hello.
Music is for people, not for critics. We haven't been, obviously the critics' darling or anything like that ever, but we're certainly a band of the people.
I don't even know if it still fits.
I mean, now we're getting some critical response after, 19 years or something like that. They're starting to go, you got to go see this live show.
The most important show of his life. Almost every show I've ever seen him give.
In order to be a good singer, you have to be completely open on stage. Your heart and soul have to come through. Otherwise, you could sound wonderful, but people fall asleep. There's a lot more heart to what he's doing, especially since he's been acting. I think that's had a wonderful effect on his singing.
Our shows over the years have become somewhat of a religious experience for me and for the band and for a lot of the fans. Why our reputation was built as a live act is because there was a lot of interaction. By involving the audience as your counterpart, you fuel each other. So as long as I'm feeling that I'm giving something back by writing songs, and it's never based on nostalgia, but it's that of a band that's growing, evolving, and performing to the best of its ability, I want to do that. And the same thing with acting. As long as I can make a contribution in a film that I think is showing some growth each and every time, then I'll want to do that.
I think he eventually will have an audience of people who are fans of him as an actor that may not even know his work as a musician.
I think John, for the most part, has kind of rolled with the times. I think he continues to reinvent himself.
I think that finally John has come to a place where he's very secure in himself, and he really has a peace about him that I've only really noticed in the last couple of years.
He just continues to move. He likes to be on the move. And it's not always just a physical move. It's more moving inside to continue the search.
When I was younger, I was one of those workaholic lunatics that just didn't feel that he was worth anything if I wasn't working, if I wasn't striving for something. I wasn't enjoying what was the moment. With time, with experience, with, age, with success, with whatever, you learn to wake up and enjoy the day, see the sun shining now.
Smoking and drinking, but I'm here.
Why are you doing it?
Because you guys are making me